Each year in Finland, around 2,000 people are officially reported missing. Most of these individuals are either found or arrive home safely, but roughly 20 of those who disappear remain lost forever. Despite this tragic truth, what links these disappearances together is the hope that they will one day return, as someone is always looking for them. The same can't be said, however, for one man from Finland who was lost for 15 years before anyone even noticed. In March 2016, Henri Mikkola, the owner of an air conditioning company in Pori, Finland, was sweeping the units in multiple properties in the area. He came across a studio apartment which needed servicing, so knocked on the door to be let in. After receiving no answer, Henri contacted the deputy landlord of the property, Mikko Pu, to call out a locksmith to get into the room. The locksmith arrived and they managed to open the door, but what lay before them would be something that neither of them would have expected. As the door swung open, thousands of unopened letters, leaflets, and magazines fell out into the hallway. The home was completely absent of its owner, and it looked and smelt as though it had been left vacant for years. The place was a complete mess, which, along with the unopened post, had other noticeably strange features. The whole apartment was wired up with makeshift electrical devices, which were considered highly dangerous and hazardous. There was no phone, yet there were several hundred speakers lying around the room, and the whole studio was completely disconnected from the electrical grid. The most bizarre item found in the property was a large handwritten note left visibly on display for all to see. A rough translation reads as follows. My apartment is not connected to the power grid, and therefore it is not permissible to conduct electrical repairs or inspections whilst I am away. The illegal and deadly electrical works of my apartment are my criminal evidence and may be touched only when I'm present. I do not have a guardian or representative who could make decisions for me. A record, as prescribed by the law, must be made for all visits to my apartment, and it must be delivered to me, as is decreed by the law. I always carry the only legal keys to my apartment. To mitigate the danger, the electricity and phone line in my apartment are now grounded and may not be hooked up to the grid. To the police officers, property manager, and members of the Housing Cooperative Board facing criminal charges: number 1, clean underwear; number 2, handkerchief; number 3, comb your hair, if you have any, before going to the courtroom. This note alone gave the impression that the occupier was not in a good mental state, and, despite the attempt at humour, had a lack of respect and trust for those in authority. This, along with the dangerous electrical setup and noticeably poor condition of the property, caused a great deal of concern for the well-being of the missing man. The apartment in question belonged to this man, Vesa Matti Francia. Vesa owned the apartment outright, yet had a few direct debits for living costs, such as a service charge to the deputy landlord Mikko. Mikko had only recently become deputy landlord in early 2016, and was previously suspicious that something was wrong when Vesa had not switched payment to his new account. Vesa's mother and father were both deceased, though he had two brothers who apparently weren't on good terms with him. He was said to have been somewhat of a social hermit, with no friends or other relatives. However, he did have a guardian by the name of Viljo Rajamäki, who was ordered to take care of Vesa due to him being declared legally incapacitated. What's odd here though, is that neither the guardian nor his brothers had previously reported Vesa missing to the authorities, and had found out he had vanished the same time as everyone else. Tapio Rantanen, a senior sergeant of the Pori Police Department, was assigned to investigate Vesa Francia's disappearance and find out what could have happened to him. He reported how the apartment was full of dusty mail, which dated back 15 years to 2001, and that nobody had even visited the property in that time, let alone lived there. So what happened to Vesa? Why was his apartment left abandoned for 15 years? Why were the electrics rigged up so badly? And why had nobody noticed it had been missing for such a long time? To try and understand this story, we have to go back to the beginning, before Vesa was even born. In 1940, 4 years before Vesa's birth, the Francia family moved to the west coast of Finland from the city of Tampere to a remote farmhouse in Nurmaku. Vesa's father, whose name is unknown, purchased the property due to it being a prime location for hunting and fishing, two hobbies he had a particular interest in. According to Vesa's mother, Laura Callio, the family weren't welcome when they moved into their new home, and the neighbouring villagers took issue with city folk. The house they bought had not had a long-term resident prior to the Francias moving in, and was usually a go-between for travellers. The villagers had become accustomed to treating the land at their leisure, walking across the grounds to collect lumber and whatever else they liked from the nearby woods. However, once the Francias became permanent residents, the villagers could no longer use the woodland areas as they pleased. Vesa was eventually born on the 1st of February 1944, and grew up in the house in Nurmaku with his father, mother and brothers. He was described as somewhat of a recluse, with little to no friends in the area. He had a strong interest in electronics and was also a lover of jazz music, so much so that he wrote several reviews and articles on the topic in the 1960s. When his father died, Vesa inherited the house, and much like his parents, he didn't get on well with the locals, but they didn't fear him like they did his father. There were supposedly many conflicts between Vesa and his neighbours in the years after his father's death. One such event involved Vesa shooting the neighbour's cats who were trespassing in his gardens, which the Francias claimed was the villagers' fault for not looking after them properly. Another involved Vesa's well, which his neighbour had allegedly dumped a heap of horse manure next to in order to contaminate the water. When Vesa reported this to the police, they apparently took no action, which infuriated him. The same neighbour then bought a German shepherd, who would roam freely amongst Vesa's property, which he saw as a direct threat. Vesa again reported this to the police, who this time ordered that the dog be kept on a leash, but this was never enforced. Tensions would reach an all-time high when the dog eventually made its way into Vesa's house, resulting in him shooting the dog in fear. After years of alleged torment by the villagers, Vesa took action and decided to file multiple lawsuits against public officials and the parliamentary ombudsman, who in his mind were inefficient, prone to wrongdoing, and not carrying out true justice. However, as a result of filing these claims in court, Vesa was declared mentally incapacitated and was placed in a psychiatric criminal hospital in Vaasa. The Finnish magazine SE covered this case in their February 1990 issue, where Vesa's mother Laura was interviewed. Now aged 80, Laura revealed their struggles with the Nurmaku community and how she believed that her son had been locked up in the hospital for almost a year without a sentence. According to the report, Laura claimed her son had less rights than the rest of the inmates, including church arsonists and child molesters, and that he was being treated as a maximum security inmate despite not receiving a proper sentencing. The parliamentary ombudsman soon started an investigation into Vesa's imprisonment. According to the hospital director, Eva Kulpi, Vesa was against all treatment, severely paranoid and threatening to staff, and his condition meant that he was in immediate need of guardianship. When asked how long Vesa would remain imprisoned, Eva replied that they can take you to live here for the rest of your life if you have gone mad. With little to no information available, it's unclear what happened during this chapter in Vesa's life, but he must have been released at some point during the 1990s, as he would later take care of his elderly mother. This event likely had a serious impact on Vesa's mental state and outlook of society, as he was said to have become extremely anti-authority since his time in Vaasa, and would later write to international courts about his treatment in Finland. This may explain some of the language used in the note left in his apartment, as he clearly had no respect for authorities, who he saw as criminals. He eventually sold the family farm to a forest industry and bought himself a studio apartment in Pori. It's likely that his mother had passed away by this point, although there is no confirmed report. Despite his supposed mental state and being assigned a full-time guardian, Vesa managed to travel to Tanzania for a holiday in February 1997. What he would have hoped to have been a relaxing vacation was about to become quite the opposite. One night during his holiday, a group of armed robbers entered the hotel wielding rifles and jungle knives. They stormed the building, firing bullets into the ceiling and attacking both staff and visitors whilst looting them of their possessions. Vesa ended up being interviewed by the tabloid newspaper Ilta Sanomat, where he explained how he was kicked in the face during the attack as they stole his money and belongings. More of Vesa's unusual behaviour can be seen during this report, where he claims that, after the attack, he was not nervous, but cold nervous, as he walked past the beaten reception workers directly to the hotel bar to order a Pepsi, to which he states he drank it without still. Despite these traumatic events, Vesa would not be put off from taking future travels, and 4 years later booked a package holiday to Crete. This time, however, this holiday would unfortunately be his last. On Thursday the 12th of July 2001, 57-year-old Vesa travelled to Crete, presumably alone, much like his previous trips abroad. Towards the end of the holiday, rather than take a flight back to Finland, Vesa for some reason instead travelled to mainland Greece, where he would visit the Finnish embassy in Athens on the 1st of August. It's not known why or how he ended up here, but he explained to officials that he had slept in a train station that night and needed help to get back to Finland. With the aid of the Finnish Ministry of Foreign Affairs, he managed to get a train ticket from Athens to Sofia to begin his journey home. 19 days after walking out of the Finnish embassy in Greece, Vesa was once again back looking for help, but this time in the Finnish embassy in Poland. He explained how he had been robbed the previous weekend by what he called the EU police, who had taken his passport, money, and a train ticket to Riga. He even claimed that he had been living in a park for a few days, surviving purely on peanuts and birdseed. When embassy staff in Warsaw tried to help Vesa, he refused to cooperate, claiming that he would not make a report to the criminals, referring to the police. This opinion may have stemmed from his past dealings with Finnish authorities, who he mistrusted deeply back in his homeland, but yet again, his behaviour seems to be questionable. Without the will to cooperate, Finnish embassy staff were unable to help Vesa, and he eventually left the building alone. This was the last time anyone saw Vesa Francia, and no one has reported to have seen him since. From this day onwards, Vesa became a forgotten man, and no friends, family, or even the guardian ordered to look after him came by to visit his apartment. It's hard to understand how not one single person could have noticed Vesa going missing for more than 15 years. Tapio Rantanen, the policeman assigned to investigate Vesa's disappearance, has since browsed through thousands of letters found in his studio apartment and investigated numerous leads to piece together what may have happened to him. When you look at the journey Vesa took from Athens to Warsaw, it's clear that he was trying to make his way back to Finland, especially as he claimed to have lost his next ticket, which was destined for Riga. How Vesa ended up losing his passport and belongings remains unknown, and it's hard to understand if his comments regarding the EU police were that of someone in the right frame of mind or the ramblings of a madman. Vesa is currently on Interpol's international list of missing people and has a yellow notice against his name, the Global Police Alert for Victims of Unexplained Disappearances. He has since been declared dead in June 2017, but would be 77 years old today if still alive. There are so many unanswered questions and bizarre circumstances surrounding Vess's disappearance, and it's hard to create a full picture as to what could have happened to him based on such little information. The limited sources available are disputed by many Finnish people I've spoken to as being sensationalist and perhaps not highlighting the truth of Vess's mental state. The note in the apartment gives me the impression that he disliked anyone in a position of authority and didn't trust them at all based on his previous experiences with them. The fact that he had an interest in electronics as a younger man may also explain how he was able to wire his apartment up, albeit poorly, separate from the electrical grid. The one part of the story that really leaves me uneasy is the role of the guardian. If Vesa truly was in need of guardianship, how is it that he was able to travel independently to far distance countries without him? And why hadn't he been checking up on his well-being for over 15 years? Vesa even mentions in the note he left that he did not have a guardian or representative who could make decisions for him, but we know that this wasn't the case. Of all the unusual aspects of this story, this is the part that unsettles me the most. However you look at the life of Vesa Francia, the fact that someone's disappearance could go unnoticed for so long is a true tragedy, and it leaves behind a mystery that may remain unsolved forever. Vesa may never be found, and his true tale may never be told. But no matter what the case may be, the story of Vesa Francia is a story that deserves to be unforgotten. Thanks for watching the video, and I really hope you enjoyed it. I just want to say a massive shout out to the r/Finland community on Reddit, and in particular a few individuals. So Alina, Leiska Henki, MK-Extremis, and Schnaufium, I think it's pronounced. So thank you guys for helping with the pronunciations and the translations of all the source material that I've gone through to create this video. Without you guys, I wouldn't have been able to do it. So thank you very much for all your help. And just want to say thank you to everyone who watched my last video as well. It's got, you know, more views than I ever expected to get, and it's been really well received. So I'll keep making these, and hopefully you'll keep enjoying them. So yeah, like I said, just make sure you like and subscribe, and stick around for more videos like this. Thank you.